Welcome back to the It's Just Sport podcast paper review. I'm Joanna Reardon.
I'm Eve Talon, and we are here to bring you the latest in women's sport. If you want to connect with us on social media, follow us on Instagram at hersport.ie and at Joanne O'Orr, and on Twitter at hersport.ie and at Joanne O'Orr underscore OX. So I think there's a lot of things have been going on, and we also have some more sport in the pipeline. So I think you're going to bring us the biggest news of the week.
So in football, incredibly exciting news. Sky Sports have just had a deal with the Women's Super League over in England. So Sky Sports have just announced a 3-year deal with the FA to become the primary broadcaster of the Barclays Women's Super League from September 2021. This is obviously huge news because it's the first time the Women's Soccer League have had a consistent broadcaster that's not the FA player over the last few times. I think the deal is worth $25 million. And the deal basically will be 75% Women's Super League and 25% to the second tier. I suppose clubs in the league will receive part of the revenue with a percentage as well going to the clubs that are in the second tier, as we've just said. It's the first time that the women's rights have been sold separately to the men's. Sky Sports Main Event, Sky Sports Premier League and Sky Sports Football, as well as BBC One and BBC Two, also covering a few games. And those other games that aren't live will also be on the FA player for anyone to see as well. The FA player is great. All you need to do is just like subscribe, log in, and there you go, you have your games. But I'm a rural person, so I love things on my TV, so this is going to be a million times like better for me. In Women's National League news, kicking off this weekend, we've got Bowes versus Treaty United, Athlone Town versus Shelburne, Wexford Youths versus Piemont, and Galway versus Cork City. So I've taken the liberty of putting together a list of names that I think people should look out for. So I suppose firstly, in Athlone Town, we've got Catherine Hinman. You know, I think the league is made up largely of youth and young players and different things like that. But Hinman is a former Northern Ireland international, and she certainly brings player experience. You know, she brings everything to the table. She's going to be in the back line of Athlone, and she's going to be the mainstay in defence. And I think that will showcase her leadership skills and her ability to read the game for Athlone Town. We've also got the first ever Swiss player to be playing in the Women's National League. Very excited. Galway Women's have bought Elena Van Niekerk. She is kind of unknown because they have used kind of very different like apps to like scout this girl out. I think for Galway, they wanted someone who was going to supply goals. They wanted a forward that was kind of always on the move, help out with support and attack and different things like that. We also have the Alex Morgan of the Women's National League in Saoirse Noonan. Although it may not be as much as what Alex Morgan went for to Tottenham, there's certainly a lot of coverage surrounding Saoirse Noonan. We covered it ourselves. I was very depressed. But she switched from Cork, and she switched from Cork Ladies Football to go all the way up to Shells. She wants a new challenge. She's going to test herself. She's going to try to break into the Republic of Ireland's women's national team. Vera is certainly looking at her as well. We also have really exciting in Wexford Youths. We've got Kim Flood. So Kim Flood has played ladies football, Australian rules, rugby and football to a high level. So you probably think that she'd be winding down her career at this stage, but no, she has decided to continue playing sport. She's gone back into the women's national league after spells with Castlebar Celtic and Raheny. So she's going over to Wexford Youths. So all very exciting. It kicks off on the League of Ireland platform. You don't have to pay for the Women's National League games, but you have to be a member. So basically subscribe and watch some Irish football and see what happens.
Yeah, I think it's very exciting, and hopefully we'll see a lot of eyes head over there, making you know, as it's been made more accessible. And there's a little bit of a lack of sport at the moment, I think, which should do really well for the women's game. So definitely something that we are looking forward to. In swimming, we've had Mona McSherry in action again. So she was competing at the NCAA Women's Championships. She competed in the 200-yard breaststroke and picked up a bronze medal behind Sophie Hansen and Ella Nelson. She broke the school record by over a second in 2:05.01, which is brilliant. And, you know, to kind of give context, the winning time was 2:03.86. So they're swimming fast times, and it's brilliant to see Mona in such flying form. She obviously had good results a couple of weeks ago as well. She also raced in the 400-yard freestyle and swam a personal best This was the fifth fastest 400 freestyle relay of the University of Tennessee history. So she's certainly making a name for herself in that college and really establishing herself as one of the great swimmers that they have. She will be back in action for the Olympic trials on the 20th to 24th of April, which is something that people should mark in their calendars. It'll be exciting to see what comes of that. And if we can bulk up the team of Shane Ryan and Tara Green that have already made qualifications. So it'd be brilliant to see some of the women getting qualification spots, and there certainly is the capacity, as there are some very fast swimmers there.
Yeah, no, it's exciting. It's really funny because I just remember Mona McSherry as like Ireland's fittest family like winner, as well as her swimming attributes. So over in boxing, Ireland's newest boxing superstar, Caitlin Phelan, has won her most recent professional fight. She took on Karina Kopinska in Luxembourg in an 8-round fight, and she impressed in a points win and dominated in every single round. So this is the fifth win from her out of five so far, so 100% record. She is Ireland's youngest professional boxer at just 21 years old. She's a proper talent, and the Sun's headline for her win was that winning feeling. So it was a must be a words, Niamh. I know you like a bit of wordplay yourself, but no, she's competed at welterweight, light welterweight, also against Kopinska, and the team have plans for her to fight at lightweight, which they believe is her like best weight and where she can kind of thrive the most. So very exciting in boxing that we have new talent up and coming, because I feel like we've always been a bit of a boxing nation for a while, and it's great to see the women's boxers come out on top.
Yeah, I know. Look, obviously there's a lot going on in boxing at the moment, and there'll be a few people looking to qualify for Tokyo, but I think Phelan is doing brilliantly at the moment, and she'd be certainly looking to follow in the footsteps of Katie Taylor. I think it's interesting that they're trying to find the optimum weight for her to fight on. She's obviously doing well in the category that she's in at the moment. And yes, the Sun headline, that winning feeling did give me a laugh when I saw it. So it was very good whoever came up with that. But look, we have a lot going on over in rowing at the moment, actually. So the 2021 European Championship are just around the corner. They'll be taking place from the 9th to the 11th of April, and the team has just been announced. So we will be sending four of Fiona Murta, Emer Lam, Afra Kyo, and Emily Hegarty. There was success at the 2021 edition with a bronze medal, and the crew has been slightly changed, which had Aileen Crowley in it. So she's been swapped out and Emily Hegarty has been put in. So it'll be really exciting to see how they get on. It's the 75% of a very strong crew last year. And obviously Emily has had brilliant success in the last 12 months. So we'll be looking forward to that. Aileen will be competing with Monika Dekarska in the pair. So this was actually the lineup that qualified the pair for the Tokyo Olympics when they competed at the World Championships in 2019. So that'd be they'd be familiar with each other, and they've obviously been rowing well together for that decision to have been made. We'll see the lightweight double of Margaret Kremen and Aoife Casey. They've also competed together on several occasions, most recently in the European Championships, both at the under-23 and senior level. They picked up silver at the under-23 level, so it's great to see them, at the senior championships and really pushing for more. They will be trying to qualify the boat for the Olympics in May in Lucerne. So will we see a change in that lineup? It's not to be sure, because obviously Lydia Heafy is down there as well, and she'd be hoping to throw her name into the hat for that. I know that it's all very competitive down in the lightweight division at the moment. Margaret Kremen actually had an Irish record there recently on the rowing machine. She broke the 2 kilometre record, which I think previously had been officially held by Claire Lam, and she broke 7 minutes, which for a lightweight is really impressive. We've mentioned Lydia already. So Lydia Heafy will be competing in the single sculls. She competed in this event in the 2020 senior European Championships, and she won the B final. So she'll have confidence from this last year, and she'll be looking to make her mark again this year. She actually had a gold medal at the under 23 event a couple of weeks before last year in the lightweight pair with Cliona Nolan. So she's been getting race experience, and we'll be looking forward to seeing what she can do in the single scull. Tara Hanlon and Claire Fearick will be brought as the reserve. So if anything is needed in the pair or the four, they'll be available. Big news, I suppose, is that Sunita Pushpuri will actually not be competing in the championships and won't be defending her titles. So she's double European champion. And so it was obviously a big decision not to compete in this. But she will be travelling over to train and compete at later competitions. So they'll all be heading over to Europe soon. In you know, preparation for this. But I think, you know, her focus really is on the Olympics this year. And I guess the decision has been made in light of that. There are other athletes down training at the National Rowing Centre, including Alison Bergen, Holly Davis, Katie O'Brien. Katie O'Brien is very exciting. She's been training with her new partner, Stephen McGowan, so we'll be looking forward to seeing what's to come with them and also with some of the other junior athletes. But yeah, there's a lot going on there, and it's great to have that back in action, you know, and see if we can get, you know, the four also has to qualify for Tokyo, as well as the lightweight double. That's what they'll be looking to do. So this will be, you know, a really good measure of where the crews are at the moment.
Yeah, no, it's incredibly exciting. And just to let you know, Niamh, over the weekend, I decided to do a bit of Marion Sonic at the Olympic Games. And I've discovered that I'm apparently one of ye now, because I've discovered that my best event is actually, I know you don't do like canoeing, but it's canoe C3. So it's like, I don't know, it's like it's Marion Sonic, that's what it's called. But I broke the, apparently I broke the Olympic record. I set a new one of 3:23 or something ridiculous like that. Obviously, I don't know, as my brother came in and said to me, he was like, we need to get you like drug tested or something. And I was like, it's a game. Yeah, no. But in Olympics and Paralympics news, that weirdly led me on there. It has been announced that we have no overseas spectators. So this obviously broke in the last few days, that there will be no overseas spectators. It has been rumored for a little while. I suppose the International Olympic Committee, the International Paralympic Committee, the Tokyo Metropolitan Government, the 2020 Organizing Committee, and the government of Japan all come together and basically said that it is not safe for Japan if this was the case, that if they did come in. I know I've been following, this is really random, but I've been following Beauden Barrett's wife on Instagram because he's playing in Tokyo now, and I feel like I've been living in Japan with her for a little bit. But yeah, they basically had an outbreak recently and the whole place shut down. I think it was basically like, oh, if this is gonna be the case with the Olympics, it's kind of weird, I suppose, for them, because I think that's really how the metropolitan government would kind of make their money back a little bit, yeah, on hosting an Olympics and a Paralympics, in terms of bringing in revenue that way. So it's a little bit weird that they won't kind of face it. I wonder, really, will it make a difference like for athletes? You know, I think, are they just kind of so hell-bent on performing that it was going to go ahead kind of no matter what? And I actually read somewhere in a poll that I think was it 96% of athletes said they'd take a vaccine if it meant performing versus 4% who said they wouldn't. And I was someone tweeted, if it was actually like, if this was a situation that had to arise, would that 4% decrease very quickly? You know, are people really going to like throw away a spot at the Olympics just for, you know, not wanting to get a vaccine? So very interesting kind of overround, but kind of sad news that we won't have any kind of weird Irish home crowd abroad taking over Tokyo. So yeah, no, fingers crossed it all goes well to them. I think everyone kind of came together and basically said that the conclusion will contribute to ensure safe and secure games for all participants and the Japanese public as well. Because I think it would be a bit of a shame if all the money was put in, international spectators came over, and then Japan had to shut down for like 6 months. I think it would be very traumatic for everyone involved.
Yeah, no, I think like what you're saying in relation to the athletes, like, you know, at this stage it's been postponed a year. They have gotten used to the normal of, you know, getting this idea into their head that there may not be spectators. And I think, you know, from the athletes' perspective, you know, people want to go out, they want to compete. It will be a different event, but people are getting used to competing without a crowd and without spectators. Obviously, I think there'll be a bit of disappointment, you know, without having family and friends there to support and you know, that bit of the atmosphere with the crowd. But I think, you know, athletes at this stage, and we've seen it, you know, lots of different sports have come back with no spectators, and people just want to get the chance to go out and perform. And obviously, you know, they've put in huge amounts of work to get there in the first place. So if it can go ahead in some format, that's what the athletes will be looking for. But I mean, in relation to Tokyo and the cost of it and everything, I mean, there's just so much in that. And, you know, it's hard to even fathom, you know, how much it could cost them if they're not able to generate any revenue from sales of tickets and that type of thing. But I guess, look, that's luck of draw at the moment. And hopefully Japan don't end up too bad off in relation to the situation. I'm not sure what can be done to support them or whatever it is, but it's certainly a difficult position to be in.
I was kind of like thinking about like fans doing like, do you know the way like when like people are doing like the long jump or like pole vault or anything like that, they like clap for the fans to like amp them up.
Yeah.
Like, you know, how's that going to work out, you know, like for everyone involved? Yeah. I think, I know like some obviously Japanese fans will be there, like that's great for them.
But yeah, like, yeah,
know,
absolutely.
If like a rival, so like, I don't know, if like a Chinese competitor is competing, I don't think the Japanese are going to stand and applaud. Like, yeah, on a bad way, like it's good, good
yeah,
near neighbor rivalry, you know?
Yeah, no, I think, look, what you're saying is that at the moment, Japanese supporters and fans are included in being able to go, which is brilliant. There will be media there, so hopefully there will be some sort of atmosphere. We'll take that as it comes and keep you updated with what the news is. But at the moment, it's no overseas, which would be disappointing for anybody that's traveling to the country. But as we said, I think people have gotten their head around that. They've, prepared for potentially having nobody there. So at least if there's some Japanese people there. But I actually, this is quite unusual. So I was in Brazil at the Olympics, and the way that crowds interact and react in Brazil was quite different to the way that we would in Europe. And there was a lot more like booing and stuff going on than I would have expected. And I don't just mean like, look, there were athletes that claimed medals that had been done for doping. People were booing at that. I can understand that. But just in general, like at different points, fans were booing. We're like, okay, like they're the top end of their sport, from their country, and they put a lot of work in, like, and you're booing them, which was just a bit unusual. I think it's not something that we've maybe experienced so much here.
Brazilians don't care, man. Like, I mean, did you hear what they were doing to Hope Solo? Because like the Zika virus had broken out in Brazil, and she put up like a stupid tweet. It was stupid, to be honest. And it was like she was in, those like bee suits that you can get, like literally, as if you're going in for bees. She had one of them on, and a Zika fly spray killer. And she put it up saying, "Prepare now for the Rio Olympics" or something like that. And anytime she went to kick the ball, they went, "Oh, Zika!" at her. Like, it was so funny. Like, she kind of deserved it. I love Hope Solo, but she kind of did deserve that. But yeah, no, like South Americans, like rivalry is intense. They're like, they're not gonna like cheer for someone just because they're at the top of their field. We're gonna get to Paris, Niamh. Like, her sport, like, that's my aim. We're gonna get to Paris. I know you've already been to Olympics. And Olympics to Paralympics. I haven't, so I need to experience it now.
Yeah, no, it is. It's such a great buzz, and I think it was a brilliant experience to be over there. At the moment, I am supposed to be going to Tokyo, and we'll see how that goes.
Of course, Niamh will get there. Like, in between, you'll just see Niamh, like, her little blonde head, like, popping up.
No, I look, that's obviously part of our job. Like, we're supposed to be going over there and reporting, and that's the situation at present. The intention is to go over, because as media, we can go over there, and we obviously want to keep bringing everybody as much coverage as we possibly can. And it's brilliant to also be able to there to support and the Irish athletes as they're competing. But that's something that we'll have to play by ear and see how everything kind of materializes. But I think enough on that. We can keep going on that for a while. But I mean, there's been a bit of a stir on Twitter in relation to the Six Nations. So with 12 days to go, there was no clarification of kickoff times for the Women's Six Nations. The Scrum Queens account highlighted this on a Twitter thread, which saw a lot of people getting irritated and upset by the lack of information. And, people are talking about how we're supposed to be moving, women's rugby forward and giving people more opportunity, and how everything's supposed to be heading in the right direction. And then we have this like lack of information, not so far away from the competitions into what's going on. And there were a few comments saying, like, do the players even know what time they're playing and all that kind of thing. And I think, to be honest, whether it's 1 o'clock or 3 o'clock for the players, yes, they probably want to know, but they know it'll, probably be the afternoon, that kind of thing. But if you actually want to generate a bit of momentum around spectators and that type of thing, and getting people buzzed for it and having it in their head when it is, I think a little bit more information maybe does need to be shared. But on Tuesday the 23rd, then, which is kind of the day after the Scrum Queens announced, and highlighted this issue, the Telegraph UK announced kickoff times, which we hope are actually the accurate kickoff times, because it has not come directly from the Six Nations organization. And when you look on the Six Nations website, it says that everybody's starting at 1 a.m. in the morning, which is obviously not correct. And so hopefully we'll have some more information on this soon. As soon as we do, we'll bring it to our audience, because we want to make sure that as many people tune in to watch the Irish team as possible. It's something that's very exciting. We have recently spoken to Beavan Parsons and also to Anna Capeless, with some really good interviews and insight into what's going on. They're excited for the tournament preparation. And the Anna Capeless interview was actually very interesting, because it was talking about that social media pressure and some of the negativity that comes with it, which we have seen in general, but through the Men's Six Nations, there was some really mean and horrible stuff said about players and tagging and everything. So Rugby Players Ireland actually released a video. It's kind of an informative series. So the first one was released last week, and it's about tackle your feelings. and you know, just kind of show some of the real commentary that actually does go on, and how we can be better, and you know, not be tagging people when we're talking about them if it's to be insulting people or talking about them. Like, would you say it to their face? You probably wouldn't.
No.
So, you know, don't be tagging people and saying it online. And you know, there are people at the end of the phone and that they are receiving the messages and that type of thing. So yeah, definitely two pieces to check out. And yeah, I mean, let's just try to be a bit more responsible on social media when we are talking about the players. But how much are you looking forward to the tournament?
Yeah, no, very excited. Like, I was really surprised when I saw some of the stuff being put up by Scrum Queens, and we still haven't had a kickoff time.
Mm-hmm.
I just kind of thought that it was like the same template as the current, like the men's Six Nations. I just kind of thought it was the same, you know, like, because no one had announced anything kind of different. I was like, oh, it'll be, you know, like 1, 2, 3, whatever. Like, basically,
it's a different format as well, you know. So.
Yeah, yeah. Like, but I still thought that they'd have the same, like, times, mm-hmm. and stuff like that. Like, I thought they'd still run with it. But no, like, it's all a little bit strange. You know, I am looking forward to the tournament overall. I'm looking forward to seeing how the Irish girls kind of get on.
Mm-hmm.
I'm kind of looking forward to seeing if, I'm not really going to say like if the professional and non-professional bridges like either like shortened or widened. I think overall, I'm just kind of interested to see how they kind of would get on that way.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, I think overall it should be great. I think it wraps up literally the day on my birthday, so it would be great to like have something to like celebrate, especially in lockdown. But yeah, no, I fingers crossed anyways, everything kind of like gets back together, because I kind of feel like every time we talk about rugby, it's in like, I'm not going to say like a negative light, but you know, like it's kind of a pity that it hasn't really like caught up with the like rest of the hype,
yeah.
you know, that we're generating throughout. But I think like in general, if you want to get excited about the girls, like the women's national team playing, you kind of have to look at this as well. You know, you can't kind of like talk about one and not talk about the other, you know, because I think that's wrong,
yeah.
like all around. Like, I think the IRFU and World Rugby have, I know they've made some issues, but they've done their best in terms of trying to like rectify them. But there's still I feel like there's a bit
a
to
long
go.
Long way to go.
There's a bit to go. Like, there's like, they have started very, like, I know FIFA and, you know, the GA and LGFA and Camogie started far behind. I feel like rugby started that fraction bit too far behind, and they're only kind of mm-hmm. catching up to what we would be accustomed to now in terms of like that kind of stuff. But geez, like, Niamh, I remember like years ago, like going to Cork ladies football matches, and they were all Ireland champions, and you'd get to mm-hmm. say, like, Kerry for a game, you get to Ratmore, and then you get a phone call, no, it's actually on in Killarney, which is another mm-hmm. 10 minute drive. So honestly, like, I'm not surprised that some of this is still kind of going on behind the scenes.
Yeah no, look, I think in relation to women's sport in general, there's a lot of moves in the right direction, and what people are looking for is just that little bit of professionalism that the men's team get in relation to, whether it's something like as simple as this in relation to letting people know when the kickoff times are and that. And it's just like, people that are tuning in want to be furnished with the right information, ready to go. So, like, let's keep moving in the right direction and keep that buzz going in getting excited for the games and that type of thing. It's like, I don't think it's specifically rugby that has, you know, issues. There's lots of organizations or tournaments claim they say they have plans, and then they don't always kind of operate in the same way that they would the men's in kind of getting stuff organized and that. But look, it's great that we'll be able to watch it all on television. We're really looking forward to it. And yeah, I mean, it sounds like all the Irish girls are really looking forward to it and have been putting in great work. So we look forward to them, you know, getting out and you know, wearing the green for Ireland.
Yeah, no, it should be really, really exciting. Niamh, I know it's not sports related, but I know you've something. I hope you didn't hear my dog barking too crazily there, by the way. But I
we
know
did.
You have. Well, I knew that was going to happen. I have no idea what it was. No one could see what was going on.
Postman or something has arrived.
you have something you want to get off your chest, I believe. You have an internal rant that's just destroying you on the inside.
I wouldn't say destroying. I just, like, I'm really not sure about these strawberry and white chocolate cocoa pops. I just don't. Like, to be honest, I can understand, like, chocolate cocoa pops totally makes sense. I mean, that's why they're called cocoa pops. And now cocoa pops are going and they're releasing strawberry and white chocolate. And I mean, like, would I have a chocolate milkshake or a strawberry milkshake? Like, yeah, probably. But I just don't know how it's going to work in a cereal bowl. I mean, if anyone's tried them, let us know what they're like. I won't be going to buy a box of cocoa pops if someone puts a bowl of strawberry and white chocolate chip cocoa pops in front of me. I will try them and let you all know. But if anybody else has a verdict, that'd be great, because to me, it just doesn't make sense in my head, like a strawberry and white chocolate on your cereal. Because, like, it's essentially Rice Krispies. So imagine putting in Moo Joo, strawberry Moo Joo into your Rice Krispies. That's kind of what it's like. Do you know what I mean? I'm not sure I'm about that.
Are you
with
a
bit of
Coke
white
Pops?
chocolate.
Are you a Coke Pops person in general? Like, I'm a, like, not to sound like a freak, I'm a Weetabix gal. Like, I just like my Weetabix in the morning.
Yeah, well, I mean, like, I don't eat Cocoa Pops every day, but when I eat a bowl of Cocoa Pops, I mean, yeah, like, I'm not against Cocoa Pops. I do enjoy a bowl of Cocoa Pops. And, you know, I have had to, you know, grow up, so I don't eat them all the time or anything. But I just, like, people get very excited about, you know, Cocoa Pops, chocolate Cocoa Pops. I just don't see the same hype for the strawberry ones. And look, I already said to you, like, I went into Tesco and saw that the Cocoa Pops there, the strawberry Cocoa Pops, were on sale already. So I don't know that the sales have gone particularly well. So if anybody has some inside scoop on this, let us know what's going on, because that's what we want to know. But,
I think we need to tag Kellogg's. We need to tag Kellogg's. We need to get
a
hashtag.
Send me
going.
Some and I'll try them. I'm happy to be proven wrong, but it just in my
head.
And
we can do it live on next week's podcast if we get our Cocoa Pops in time. Like, we're not even going to mess around. We can watch Mew's reaction, like, live as it's happening.
I'll give you a full verdict. But, I think that's all we have. We've got some exciting sport coming up. So we're going to have the rowing and the rugby kicking off very soon. Obviously, we have some Women's National League kicking off this week as well. So actually there's quite an amount going on, and we'll be keeping you updated with everything. If there's any news that we've missed, be sure to get in touch with our social media channels. So on Instagram, that is hersport.ie and Joanne O'Orr, and on Twitter it is hersport.ie and @JoanneO'Orr_OX. So that's all today.
There you go, Niamh. I'm glad you got that off your chest. I'm glad we had a good time. And I'm glad we got to report on very important news. Hersport.ie, always delivering the most important news to your ears.
Of the day. All right, sure, look, I'll talk to you later.
Cheerio.
Bye.